lately, I've seen a lot of my brothers and sisters in Christ making comments questioning the faith of other Christians based on their politics in this election and the past election as well. Seems like this goes on every now and then. And the questions do seem legitimate. You know, how could a Christian possibly vote for or support a person who lies so much or who is so rude and crude and insulting of other people? That's not a Christ-like attitude. You know, or someone who's a serial adulterer, someone who, you know, supports these harsh immigration policies, someone who, you know, seems to buddy-buddy up with dictators. And then on the other hand, you get people saying, how can a Christian, how can a follower of Christ who knows the teachings of the Bible follow someone who lies so much as this politician does, who has been in office for decades and gotten rich serving the people? You're not supposed to get rich in service. You're supposed to do it because it's service. Right, people who flip-flopped on these different issues where they used to be for this, but now they're claiming they are the paragon of virtue defending it. People who, you know, he doesn't actually seem to maybe be there all mentally. He's just an empty suit, a puppet whose strings are being pulled, or a party that supports abortion. How could you possibly vote for that? And on and on and on it goes. And the conversations and the arguments between brothers and sisters in Christ, on one side arguing about the evils of the person or the policies of this party, and then the other side about the evils of the person or the party on this side, and we divide and we quarrel and we let this define us. I do believe that there are born-again Christians who are Democrats. And I believe there are born-again Christians who are Republican. And I have seen people convincingly argue that you should not vote for a person of such horrible character because it will be harmful to this nation. And I've also seen people convincingly argue that you cannot support a party with those sorts of policies because it will be harmful to this nation. So I wanted to offer, in this really tense moment, in all this bickering and arguing and the inflaming of emotions, people shunning, ostracizing others, breaking relationships over politics. So I just wanted to offer my thoughts. Maybe they'll help, maybe they won't. If they do, great. If they don't, flush them, whatever else helps you. Here's how I approach the issue of voting in America, where you may have support for or vote for someone who is displaying sinful character or whose platform involves sinful policies. The fact is that America, whatever she was founded to be, whatever she once was, it seems to me is no longer a Christian nation. We are living in a post-Christian culture. It is not Christianity that dominates and establishes the cultural norms and principles in which we live. While there are indeed vestigial pillars, aspects of Christian teaching that remain in society, the fact is that we seem to very much so be living in a culture that is not only based on other principles, that can often also be hostile towards Christianity. So is there somewhere in Scripture that I can go to that gives me an example of how the people of God live in such an environment and how we act? And indeed, there is. Jeremiah 29. In Jeremiah 29, the Jews have gone into exile, going into Babylon, and Jeremiah is writing a letter to the exiles in Babylon, and in that letter, he writes to them, verses 5 through 7, he writes, that, hey, they're to put down roots. Hey, look, there where you're going, I want you to buy property. I want you to get a house. I want you to have family. I want you to give your sons and daughters in marriage. And I want you to put down roots, establish yourself in the community. Don't just kind of be there, but live life in that community, in that pagan setting. In verse 7, he says this, that you are to seek the welfare of the city. For in its welfare, you will find your welfare. They are God's people, yet they are called to seek the welfare of an idolatrous and wicked society that is based in idolatrous and wicked ideas, that is run by idolatrous and wicked men seeking idolatrous and wicked policies. And yet God tells them, get involved. You're going to be there? Be there. Establish yourself. Have family. Have community. Be a part of, seek and work for the welfare of the place where you are. And so what you end up having is there in Babylon, you have God-fearing Jews working with and for pagan Babylonians in business. And you would have God-fearing Jews who worked with and worked for pagan Babylonians in government. We actually get a little bit of a picture of this, what it may have looked like in the book of Esther. Gone are the Babylonians. Who we're dealing with in the book of Esther are the Persians. They came in, they conquered the Babylonians, but it's still the exact same situation where you have God-fearing Jews, the people of God, in a situation where they are in a dominated pagan idolatrous culture where they still have to live and function. In the book of Esther, we see that Esther and her cousin Mordecai, they both live. They seem to have some degree of success. They operate within the city of Susa, which is, I believe, a capital city there of the Persian Empire. We're not told what exactly Mordecai does as a profession, but obviously he has some proximity to the halls of power. He has some position of stature. Says that he sits in the gate of the king. Not he's just sitting there, you know, spending his days whittling away or, you know, begging or something. He has some position of stature. We're not told exactly what it is. And apparently Mordecai and Esther have some kind of level of success in their lives. And so here we see both of them throughout the story moving about, operating within, supporting, interacting with, even allying with pagan and idolatrous government and government officials. What I see demonstrated in Scripture and what appears to be commanded by God to his people in a pagan, idolatrous, sinful setting is that when the people of God are in an idolatrous nation with idolatrous government staffed by idolatrous people, right, they're supposed to seek the welfare of the city. And here we are, Christians, in America in 2020, in what I believe is very much a post-Christian civilization, a society that has forsaken the principles of God seen in the Bible. They've moved on to other ideals, other principles. We are surrounded by an idolatrous culture, under an idolatrous government, staffed by idolatrous people, with idolatrous men on the ballot. Do you understand that? There is no godly choice on the ballot. Neither man at the top of this ticket has godly character that a Christian should want in a leader. Neither one of these men, neither party, is driven by godly principles that a Christian should want to see as guiding ideals. Both parties, both choices, will result in consequences that no Christian should hope to see unfold. But as God's people in an idolatrous nation, surrounded by an idolatrous people, we should seek the welfare of the city. Fact is, Jesus is not on the ballot. There is no godly man on the ballot. There is no godly party that's going to represent us. There is no perfect Christian party. There's no Bible party. The option is not there. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, which one of these godless, idolatrous men, as leaders of these idolatrous parties in this idolatrous culture, will be better for the welfare and prosperity of the nation? And that's something that we as Christians, as followers of Christ, that we can disagree about in good faith. I think we should take a little time to look at our situation and to look across the aisle at our brothers and sisters in Christ who have a different idea of what is going to benefit the city, the nation, the culture in which we live, and extend a little grace. Because here's the thing, as you look over at that Christian, that brother and sister in Christ who is going to go into that ballot box and vote for that man you hate, that party you can't stand because of that evil character and those evil policies, the party you're voting for is no less led by a man who is godless and sinful and pushing policies that likewise are godless and sinful. It's just the nation we live in. It's the reality of the world that we're in. We don't get to have a good godly man on the ballot. None of them ran. And when they have run, they don't tend to get elected. It's been a while. It's just the reality of the situation we're in. So as we go to vote, I hope we vote with a clear conscience, knowing that we're not going to get someone perfect. We're an idolatrous nation, people of God, living among people who are not. We can't expect non-believers to act like believers. And so we take the situation we're in and we work for the welfare of our city.